We are here to have a conversation around the topic of cities, sustainable cities. Is it good for the global north and not for the global south? We are happy that this issue is addressed in these European Development Days. We waited a long time for this to happen. And we hope this is a momentum for cities, and we hope that this momentum will be translated in the adoption of SDG 11 on sustainable cities in New York next September. But this conversation should add on this advocacy for cities. But we won't allow that it be just a celebration. We want that hard questions are addressed so that we have a compelling message, the message that can bring together all the conviction that we need for people to understand that we are going into a century of cities. And we are almost there. On this panel, we are privileged to have a lot of very important voices. And I will start by the youth. And you know, these young people are challenging us, but also they are the future. So mine is to tell you that we hope a lot from you, from what you represent, and for what you'll be bringing in this conversation. And then we'll have slum dwellers. I will go back to the presentation afterwards. But slum dwellers as a new stakeholders coming up very strongly, because unfortunately, 70% of our cities, particularly in Africa, are made of slums. And these people have been sidelined for so long. And they are now voicing their case, and they know what they want for the city. So I will be very happy to hear from you. We are also on this panel, a mayor, the mayor of the city of Monrovia, coming from Liberia. Liberia hit the news because of the Ebola. And guess what? This lady, with the leadership of the country, has made wonderful to turn this Ebola as a mobilizing force to building Monrovia as a sustainable city. We welcome your input in this conversation. And then we go to the thinker of our cities worldwide. Mr. Johan Kloos is the first name I call on this stage, because he has the responsibility to drive us towards this century of cities. He has the responsibility to prepare the next UN conference on human settlement, which is named a conference of cities. And we'll welcome his views on this conversation. And I hope he'll have strong views. Then next to him, you have a French development agency. These people are in this business for a very long time. And they were the first to jump to give direct lands, direct funding to cities as donors, not as technical or partners, but as donors. And this was a very good move. And this shows that they believe in cities for a long time, and their input in the conversation will be as well appreciated. And of course, we have our guest, the European Commission, we are privileged to be housed by them in these European Development Days. And we are thankful for the organizers of these days to have chosen to work on this topic. And I must remind us, this is a consortium, and we were selected. It was a huge selection, a difficult selection process that this topic went through, and we won. And we can be privileged to say that we convinced the European Development Days organizers to select this topic, and this was a consortium of Cities Alliance, AFDGIZ, Habitat for Humanity, UN Habitat, and UCLGA, the United Cities and Local Government of Africa. I think this introduction is long enough, and I'm not showing example of what I want to do during this conversation. Number one, I want to tell you that we have a translation with French and English. English is 4, French is 5, Anglais 4, Français 5, pour ceux qui ont des machines de traduction. I want also to tell you that our wonderful device, this, we were so excited about this device. It is down. We won't use it. So since I know how to calculate logarithm with the table, which my son don't know, we will use the old fashion. But to use the old fashion, we should be very disciplined. So I will put on the screen 2 questions. And I will ask you to raise your hand and tell me, and you have only one option. The first question, you raise your hand. The second question, you raise your hand. But one option. If you vote 2 times, you are expelled from this room. Right? Then we'll go to the panel. And you will feel free to ask questions to the panel. But after I've allowed you to do so, I'm the master of this. So I will allow you to do so, and then you ask questions. So we will keep it lively. And every question is allowed as long as it is on the topic. If you bring something that is outside the topic, I will stop you. Then at the end of the conversation, we'll have again this voting that we are going to do now. And we close our session by 3:30. And I hope we'll stick on this timing. So, Gonzalo, can you just send us the questions on the screen? So this is an interactive session. Please, you've got a question here. What is the biggest obstacle for cities to contribute to sustainable growth and development in Africa. You have 6 options. You vote only once. 1 option. So who is for option number 1, significant infrastructure backlogs? Who? Okay, this is not your views. Lack of planning. I have more or less 12 hands up. 17. Oh, I miss. Who I miss? Okay, 17. Then, weak policy frameworks, lack of national government support. Who is counting now? How many? 45. Urban poverty, lack of qualified staff, lack of qualified staff, not that many, 2, 5. Urban poverty, okay. Social exclusion, okay, so you see that number 3 was your choice, the majority choice, that this is where emphasis should be put from now on. Not ignoring the others, but this is where emphasis should be put. Question number 2, Gonsalvo, question number 2. Okay. You know this urban-rural approach? I've been dividing the community of donors. What to do first? Is it urban? Is it rural? So there are many options here. Number 1 says rural should be the priority because most of the African people live in rural areas. Who is for this one? 3 people. Urban should be the first because most of the GDP is produced in cities. Who is for this one? Not many, 1. Number 3, both need to be addressed. Who is for this one? A large majority for now. And number 4, we shift from sector to territorial approach. Okay, so these are your orientation that in this case, for donors, if you have to advise them, you say you address the 2 and you try to shift from sector to territorial approach. Now, let's go back to our panel, and I will ask a first question to this panel. Is urbanization a problem or an opportunity for development and for growth? The panelists, you have, say, 1-2 minutes to address this. And I will ask SDI to respond first. And SDI is represented here by Michela Patel, who is a board member of SDI, maybe the chair even. So, Sheila, what is your views?
So first of all, thank you for inviting me and my organization to participate in this very interesting discussion. First of all, we want to say on behalf of poor people who live informally in cities that they come to the city in order to improve the quality of their lives, which means that the kind of life that they had before did not fulfill their aspirations. The challenge is, to what extent does coming to city do that? And at the present moment, it is very clear that the arrangements in the city neither want, neither seek to improve, or to make investments in transforming poor people's lives. But communities have decided that regardless of what anybody else wants, they will strive to transform their own lives and look for ways by which this can be done. And we believe that in the Global South, where, like you said, there are 70% in many places of slum dwellers, very soon the politics and the sheer quantity of poor people seeking change will transform those cities to work for everybody. We hope that everybody else will join that aspiration.
Thank you so much, Sheila. Then, Mr. Yuan Close, who is the executive director of UN Habitat, what are your views on this?
Okay, thank you very much also for inviting me and UN Habitat to participate in this debate. I think that urbanization, of course, is a problem, a challenge, whatever. But if you ask me the question again, I would say none. Because I think that the most interesting question about urbanization is that it's a prerequisite of sustainable development. We don't know of any community, any society that has developed without urbanization. I am stating that aspect because there's a lot of prevention against urbanization. There's a lot of people who say, oh, urbanization is something unwanted, is something that is happening, but is not good for the country because it tends to concentrate the poverty, it tends to increase the problems of insecurity, etc., etc. And I think that this approach, which is very common, it's a very dangerous approach because if the cities concentrate poverty, it's because there's poverty. Then we are not really taking the adequate steps to address the issue. Urbanization is a process by which the human societies improve their conditions of life, as Sheila Patel has said. And the question is that if cities are well planned and well managed, this capacity of increase the value and productivity of the society and prosperity, it's also increased. And if the cities are badly managed or badly planned, the potential to provide development and prosperity is not as high. And I think that this is the real question. How we team together and how we make sure that the ones that are in charge, the ones that have the responsibility, address the questions generated or presented by the facts of urbanization. Urbanization is a must, urbanization is happening, then the question is how we improve the urbanization in order that it provides better common goods and better prosperity for the society. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Urbanization a must, provided it is well managed, well planned. This is what you are saying. Now, I want the view of the mayor of Monrovia. Madame Vogo is the mayor of Monrovia. She defeated Ebola. And she is here as a testimony of what a leadership can do when something like Ebola, which is a very dangerous disease, hit a city. Madam Vogel, your views are very important for us here.
Thank you very much for having me. And I'd like to say I didn't defeat Ebola. My communities, the grassroots people in Liberia, defeated Ebola. When we took it to the communities, they defeated Ebola. In other words. You asked the question if urbanization is good or bad for development. And I like to say it is both good and bad in the context of Monrovia. Monrovia was developed with all the social benefits for 500 people, and we have 1.6 million people living in Monrovia today. The stress that it places on these many people coming into 22 square miles of city, where the city is 90% privately owned, creates a big problem. Urbanization in that context really and truly is not beneficial to the citizens themselves, because there's limited opportunity for them to grow, for them to have businesses, for them to receive social benefits like such as good schools, homes, you know, and so forth. So when we look at it, it is a problem. Is it an opportunity? Yes, it is. Because when it is well planned, like the previous speaker said, it can become an opportunity for development. Because a well-planned city around making sure you have homes for those who are in settlements, like the slum dwellers, make sure you have schools for kids who are coming from the rural area, because they did run into the city because they thought we'll have better schools and hospital, it becomes an opportunity. And so for me, my answer will be it can be a problem and it can be an opportunity.
When I told you that this is a new kind of leaders, some people doubted. But in Africa, we are used to leaders who say, I bring you this. I promise you that. And this is a leader who says, it's not me, it's the community. Another round of applause for this kind of leaders. So now we go to our future. Our future is here represented by Miss Evie Sherop Langhart from Kenya. And she's the voice of the future. What do you think about cities today, bad or good?
Today, most African cities, the state that we are in is because they have been mismanaged. The concept of urbanization has not been properly managed by the various governments, and that is why we have, like she said, slums and lack of services. But I personally believe for the future that urbanization is an opportunity for growth and development in Africa. But for us to get there, there are many things that need to be done. And one of them is that the governments, both local and national governments, to realize the link between economic growth, economic development, and urban growth. Because that will ensure that we're not just focusing on sectors, for example, just development in terms of just health or development just in terms of education, but we're focusing on development and growth in cities as a territory, towards territorial growth. So if we move that way, I believe it will be an opportunity for everyone. Thank you.
Okay, What I gather from what you say is that there's no point choosing between rural, urban. Urbanization is here to stay. The benefit of urbanization will depend on the way we address it. on the way we plan it, and on the way we put the people, the communities, at the center of this urbanization management. And when we did this, the first attempt to have your ideas on what to do, you said that there is a lot to do in terms of having the framework of urbanization right. Now, I pose a second question to you. Do you think, and this is for the panel, that national governments and international agencies are doing enough for the management of urbanization, for the management of cities? Are you on the defense side of it, or are you on the blaming side of it? I will ask SDI to start first, Slum Dwellers International. What do you think? Are government doing enough? Are partners doing enough?
Our opinion is that urbanization, even today, after we keep saying that we are an urban planet, I don't think most of our national governments, and definitely most of the international organizations, acknowledge how important it is to look at cities and look at ways to transform them to make them sustainable. I think there is more rhetoric and very little investment in urban areas. And there is a vision that just because they are supposed to be engines of growth, that the issue of equity, the issue of inclusiveness, the issue of addressing all the problems that we have all stated will disappear because they have become engines of growth. In reality, what they're doing is producing immense inequities. Like our honorable mayor said, most of the land belongs to private. Governments don't have resources. And poor people and their own sets of expectations are falling apart because they expect everybody else to do things for them. And so what SDI seeks to do is to create organizations of their own people, saying we are not going to sit and be beneficiaries and consumers of whatever handouts you give them. We will be partners with whoever wants to make investments in development. And our first partnership is with city mayors and with local communities and with young people. Because if we do not sort out our cities today, more than 70% of our cities are young people who are going to inherit this mess. And so as a generation that came into cities to improve the quality of our children's lives, which undoubtedly has better possibilities in cities than they had in where they lived before, we see that a collaborative, horizontal, alliances and partnerships will give cities a chance. And we believe that national governments and international agencies continue to remain vertical and hierarchical. And city cultures will not accept that. The local actors have to drive that development, and everybody else has to support us.
Madam Mayor, how do you react to this? Is it your practice? How do you react to what was said? Because he's saying, unless you collaborate with slum dwellers, young people, in a way that give them the driving seat, you will not get where you should be getting to. So what are your views? And are you doing it?
Well, in Liberia, we are currently working with slum dwellers because my opinion and what I try to bring to the city government is that if you want to improve the conditions of the slum dwellers, you have to go to them and ask them what they want you to do for them. Most of the time, national and international organizations come in and say, we will do this for you, or we will do that for you. We need to change that a little bit. We have national priorities, we accept that, but we need to make sure when we're going into communities, especially when you look at Liberia in the context of having at least 70% of Monrovia today is what we call slum dwellers living in Monrovia. We need to go and ask them, what can we do to help improve your condition, your living condition?
Madam, because in a conference you can say so, but how do you do that concretely? You need to go and ask. How do you do that?
You have to dialogue with them. We go and we go into the communities, we ask them, we meet the residents, we sit with them, and once they give it to us, we can then come back to them and say, these are the things we can do for you based on what you ask us to do. We're going to either find the means of doing it from the national government or from the local government resources, but you must change this idea of going into a community, and I agree with her, and just telling people, this is what we're coming to do for you. We must go there and ask them, what do you need, and develop programs around their priorities, not our priorities.
Local governments, that is demand-driven. Is it what you are saying?
Yes. Yes. I agree with
it. Now, I don't know. UN Habitat, what is your views here? Are you buying what they are suggesting, that we don't go there and come and say we are an international community, we know from international experience what should be done in a place?
We don't prescribe recipes because urbanization, it's a political process. Urbanization is a human creation. It's a collective creation, it's a human society creation. As the communities of the bees, the Hambi, it's done by instinct. The city, which is our way of living in community, is not done by instinct. It's done by political creation, as every collectivity, everything that is collective in the done by humans, it's a political creation. And in that sense, the city is a complex living organism that requires a lot of things. Of course, the engagement with the participation of the dwellers and the people living there is fundamental because without that, there's no possibility of a democratic and participatory and equalitarian society. At the same time, what is lacking also in many parts is a clear leadership. There's no clear, intention. There's no design of the city. There's no vision of the city. And you cannot build a prosperous city without a vision. I don't want to make sacred any of the two, the top down and the bottom up. Both need to be there. Because and they are strictly necessary. And then what is needed is the dialogue between both sides. And it's not just with the mayor and the dwellers, which is very important and fundamental, of course. And this is it's a fundamental. This is the beginning of the beginning. I even don't understand how somebody can think about a city without this kind of dialogue. But more important, what is lacking today is a good relationship between the national government and the local government. National governments tend to delegate everything that is problematic at local level to the mayors. And they try to clean their hands, saying, oh, this is not my subject. This is the responsibility of the mayor. But at the same time, the national government is the government who decides the laws affecting urbanization, decides the founding systems to the city, decides many things. Usually, for example, usually the security policy of a nation is on the national government hands. But I've seen many presidents that they blame the mayor for the problems of security in one city. I would say that this is cynicism. Then there's no a kind of magic recipe that will solve all the questions. Urbanization is a very serious topic. It should be a national policy. And on top of that, then, of course, it should be well done. And the basics of being well done is a profound process of consultation and participation of the people living in the cities. But as important is the bottom-up policy, equally important is that the ones that are the leaders, they make very clear what are their responsibilities. Because if a city fails, if it's 70% of the people is living in slums, we need to identify a responsible of that reality.
Oh, I would wish that a national government of Africa be represented on this panel. But unfortunately, we don't have one. So,
why?
We don't have one. This why? Is the fact that I'm not
why?
Here. Why? I don't know. Maybe we were not clever enough to invite them. But for sure, what you just said challenge this panel on two ways. Number one, you say bottom-up and top-down are necessary both. And I tend to share these views. But then number two, you say, if who is to blame if we have 70% of the slums? And then I will say, is it pointing fingers that matter? So mine is to say, how can we come with a cooperative and collaborative governance that will lead to a better management of urbanization? I think this is your views as well. And what I want to see is that these views are also translated into the cooperation agenda. So I will ask the EU Commission, what do you think? Are we doing the right thing or are we not doing the right thing? And can you elaborate on this top-down and bottom-up approach as well?
Yes. In fact, I would like to come back on this issue, national and local governments, because in the first questions that you addressed to the audience, it came out very clearly that the major obstacle for most of the people is represented by the policy framework, which is not strong enough, and by the government, national government that don't give enough, let's say, support to local authorities. I would add also that another specific problem is that most of the countries in Africa, they have an institutional structure which is characterized by a strong configuration of centralization. And this has been basically, for historical administrative reason, also has an impact on the way how we deliver our development support. Because we have been favoring, in structuring our support, we have been favoring a kind of thematic sector approach, in which we discuss, we go in the country, we discuss with the national government, with the Ministry of Energy, with the Ministry of Transport, with the Ministry of Health, of Education, and then we have a kind of, I would say, sectoral approach. In this one, of course, is mainly top-down, because we discuss with the top-level national governments, and our discussion with local authorities is minimal. That is, I think this is our fault, and especially with the municipalities, with mayors, historically our development cooperation has been very weak. So basically what we do, we work on vertical sectors, but we miss the spatial integration of this. And when it comes this to the urban context, the problem becomes even more difficult because of the complexity of the issues. So when we talk about financial contribution, I would say yes, we give a lot. Because if you are looking at all the projects that we carry out in urban context, there is a lot. But unfortunately, these are projects that are water projects, energy projects, transport projects, and there is not a concept behind which gives a comprehensive approach to urban development. This, I think, in my opinion, is the big difficulties and is our big fault. So I think now what we need to do is to start having a new vision in which we address urban development in a comprehensive way, covering these spatial integrations.
Thank you very much for this input. And we hope that it will translate into the procedures of the European Union, which are unfortunately very much focusing on national government. But I know that you are making efforts in that regard. We just signed a partnership agreement with the Association of Local Authorities throughout the world. And this, I hope, will be a new beginning in the way the European Union does business in development. Now, we've got around the corner the COP21 in Paris coming up. And many people think that this climate change battle will be won or lost in cities. But guess what? The cities are not part of the negotiations. And we want to see if it is your belief that cities are part of the solution to climate change, or is it that it's just a recipient but not really a player? And what can you advise cities to do to have their voice heard? And what can you advise national government to do to consider cities in this negotiation? As I phrased the question is a little bit differently from what you receive, but I thought that this is the way this session can provide guidance to the negotiation process in Paris. So I will ask, first of all, the host country of this Paris talks to give us his views. And Mr. Philippe Orliange is the Executive Director for Strategy at the France Development Agency. What do you think that these people should be doing? Is cities part of the solution or not? And how can they voice their case? Or what do you advise the French government to do for cities to be heard in Paris?
Merci. Je vais commencer par une digression. Ça laisse le temps à ceux qui ont besoin d'un équipement de traduction de s'en saisir. Un homme politique français qui s'appelait Georges Marchais, dans les années 70, est interrogé par un journaliste qui lui pose une question. Et il répond, et la réponse n'a rien à voir avec la question. Et le journaliste lui dit « Mais ça n'est pas ma question ». Et Marchais lui dit « Oui, mais ça, c'est ma réponse ». Donc, je vais commencer par répondre à la question que vous ne m'avez pas posée, qui est celle sur laquelle je suis le plus compétent, qui est la question précédente. Et en répondant à la question précédente, j'apporterai un élément de réponse à votre deuxième question. Et comme c'est la première fois que je prends la parole, je vais dépasser les 2 minutes que vous m'avez allouées.
Pas de problème.
Premièrement, est-ce que les agences de développement soutiennent suffisamment les villes ? Réponse, non. Il y a des progrès. Dans les progrès, il y a le fait que, par exemple, une institution comme DEFCO se soit dotée d'une stratégie d'accompagnement du développement urbain qui regarde le sujet non pas de façon sectorielle, mais de façon intégrée. Dans les progrès, il y a le fait qu'il y ait dans le nouvel agenda du développement un ODD sur les villes. C'est un très grand progrès. Mais il y a une marge de progression considérable. Si on regarde quelles sont les agences de développement,
what is the leeway?
De développement qui aujourd'hui,
what are the which development banks
avec des villes
are nowadays able to work directly with cities? And I'm not talking about technical cooperation, because that's already ongoing. I'm talking about investment programs that need public investors who are capable of investing into cities in a direct manner. Only 2 institutions are capable of this today, is the French Development Agency and the Latin American Development Bank. It's not enough. Unfortunately, when you have international negotiations on funding, this topic is not visible enough. And the reason being that the topic of financing, funding local governments is not high enough on the international agenda. From a political point of view, maybe the reasons being several, including what my colleague mentioned, and also because the perception of local governments is not efficient enough, and there's a change that is needed there. In international organizations, we need to understand that we cannot fund sustainable development without being able to work directly with local governments and with good relations with national governments, but we need to work with them directly. AFD has experience on funding public lighting in Dakar, for example. And this is a very good example of the role that development agencies can have when lending to cities, and the advantage compared to commercial banks or development regional banks, BOAD, Latin American Development Bank, they are also major funding actors for local governments. And when you talk about this, it's also true when you fund climate change. We fund projects that also have positive impact on climate change. And the projects that deal with cities are very important to limit greenhouse gases, adaptation programs. 10 cities in Africa are directly exposed to the consequences of climate change. And the agenda there is a common one. And in climate change negotiations, not in the negotiations per se, but in shaping the positive agenda and the role of cities and territories, is a very important feature. And to reply to your second question, France and through its development agency is providing support to that. With the limitations that I mentioned earlier on in negotiations at international level, local governments are not represented, but they are around these negotiations. And in a positive agenda, we must cater for cities. So you had two replies for the price of one. I'm buying, says the moderator.
Est-ce que la Commission européenne répond comment à cette question?
How does the European Commission tackle this?
Et comment vous nous préparez pour Paris?
And how are you preparing us for Paris?
For us, nobody can deny that that when we talk about climate change, cities are a major contributor to pollution and to the reason for the climate change. But we have to also to understand that there is a very good opportunity to work on cities, because there we have the big density, and it's there where this urban density made possible to provide more benefits. We can provide cheaper access to water, to energy, to other services, and at the same time fighting climate change. Because especially when we talk to Africa, it's clear that if we discuss about climate change, we cannot go to the government, to African governments, or to African, let's say, national and also local government, and to say that they have to do something for climate change. See, at the moment, it looks like Africa has contributed, I think, 3% of the global emissions. So we should not ask African governments to do something on climate change. What we are doing is to propose projects that are addressing development cooperation, economic growth, and that in the way how they are implemented as a kind of a secondary effect, but very important, these projects are also addressing climate change. This is the way how we are dealing with the problem.
Thank you so much. And finally, what does our future leader think about this agenda of climate change?
In Africa, like the EU commissioner has said, we only account to like only 3% of the causes of climate change. Climate change. So in Africa, the main issue that is to be addressed is on the environmental issues, like inadequate household water and sanitation, air pollution, and pollution of our water sources. Those are the real issues on the ground that might not contribute so much to climate change, but are the issues that are affecting so many people, the 70% of people who live and dwell in the slums each and every single day. So in Africa, awareness, a lot of awareness needs to be done, even as we focus on specialized training or building up a capacity of people who are able to create systems, environmental systems that are sustainable and are able to ensure that Africa has environmental systems that will continue for many centuries to come.
Okay, so maybe your neighbor want to say something about it? Sheila?
I just want to say three things. First of all, as part of the climate change discussions and negotiations, there is a whole section on equity and social justice. And it's very important to acknowledge that 60 to 70% of people in cities don't have energy justice. People are using fuels that are destroying their health. There are lots of those kinds of issues that are also part of the climate change program, which are very important. The other very important thing which we as slum dwellers believe and we are struggling to look at the role and contribution we can make in this, we don't believe that the issues of the cities are represented as adequately as they should, given that the future of this planet is going to be more urbanized. And so how should cities manage their energy? What should those cities that are struggling right now to actually begin to produce universal energy for everybody, what kind of choices do they have? What kind of support they will get? I think those are very important issues for the future.
Okay.
And they affect us very deeply.
Well, I think it is now time to go back to you and ask you if you have questions to raise to one panelist or the other. But please, we need that as many people as possible can ask questions. So go to the question. Don't go into elaboration. We all are grateful to the panelists and so on. We don't want to thank them. We will thank them at the end with applause. Go to your question and put it to the one that you need to address directly, or put it to the panel as well. Yes, sir. Over there.
Mohammad Yassin, University of Udine, Italy. Why you are putting it in framework of North-South? Because the major actors who are implementing transformation of cities in Africa, majority of them, they are neither from the North nor from the South, but basically from the East or from the multinationals who are not binding themselves to be North or South. So why we are putting it in this framework? And why we are adopting this classical thinking? We have to find innovative way, because what I am hearing here and what I have noticed in on the ground is different. I'm coming recently from Ethiopia, where I have seen major transformation of the town. And what are transforming, who are transforming the town are the Chinese. They are neither, none of those who are mentioning here. So they are not having even wider visioning of this. So why we adopt, why don't we adopt innovative way of rethinking the urban planning?
Point taken. Thank you. Another question? Yes, ma'am.
Je peux poser ma question en français?
Yes, can I ask my question in French, please? Thank you. I haven't heard much about new forms of urbanization and participation of civil society, for example, through local cooperatives or renovation in slum areas. But I think it's important to take those kinds of concepts into account in defining public policy and also in supporting them. Thank you.
Question? Yes.
Thank you. Deepali Sood from Habitat for Humanity. My question is especially for my same gender, so all the three women here. My question really is about the right of women when it comes to right to property and access to land. So from each of your point of view, as a youth, as a civil society, and as a part of the government, what strategy can we apply when it comes to making sure that women actually have right to property when it comes to slums or when it comes to urbanization? And not just the legal framework, but also when it comes to customary law, you know, society not allowing women to inherit property, for example. And in our country, India, we know that, not just in the slums and in the poor people, but also in middle class. So if you could just give me one, maybe just one sentence each, would be fantastic. Thank you.
Another question? Yes, sir.
(Clears throat) Bonjour, je m'appelle Adrien Licha, je viens de
Yes, hello. I'm from an organization in Istanbul. It was said that more development agencies need to take risks in financing municipalities. But I wanted to ask what these risks are, what are the obstacles, and how can we work together to reduce the risks and therefore encourage development agencies to provide greater financing to towns and cities?
Do we have another question? Yes, another one here.
Thank you. I had a question for the panel. I wanted to know their ideas on not bilateral, but on trilateral, multi-sector cooperation. So development countries, developing countries, and Western countries, how they should or not exchange best practices on urban issues. It's a bit related to the first question, by the way.
Thank you. One here.
Okay, thank you. My question is for the Miss Mayor. Then you address about with the slum dwellers to at least to address their problem, just go to them and ask their what they need and to address their problem. But mostly in Africa, most of the slum dwellers is considered as illegal settlement. So how do you consider this illegality and also go to there and discuss with them? Because mostly we marginalize them because they think that we are not legally settled on the countryside and also with the city boundaries. So please address this issue.
I had another finger up, down, back there, and then here.
Hi there, I'm Cyril Dwork, student in Leiden University. And we've talked about energy in terms of global warming. My question is talking about energy in terms of sustainability in the cities. We have someone from West Africa, and I know that in Nigeria, for example, there's like 340 days out of 356, you have electricity shortages in the city of Lagos and in other cities. And yeah, we talk about planning and everything, but like for the cities in Africa has grown much faster than energy can provide it. Shouldn't we think about first having the infrastructure before like changing everything? Like, this is a question for the mayor and maybe for the commission and the aid agencies.
Yes, here. And then the last one here.
Hello, thank you. I work for Unitar ITCO, and I have a question that you mentioned before in the beginning. The SDG 11, the urban SDG, as I said, for the panel, do you think it should be one goal or should be an overall goal for the 17 SDGs? And related to that, the smart city approach, is that an opportunity for the sustainable cities, the new technology, or do you think that's too far for it? Thank you.
And the last one here. Unfortunately, the last one here because of time.
Thank you very much. Many thanks to the speakers. I'll try to be as brief as possible, but I also wanted to be provocative.
Okay, go ahead.
Yes, along Basi, bear with me. I just feel that we need to face the facts. Urbanization is not taking the right process in Africa. And things are not going to happen by just talking to people and trying to ask them what they need and we give it to them. I think it's important we need to ask ourselves the first question that we had from here, who is leading urbanization? Who is in charge? What's the role of the public leader? What's the role of government? What's the role of the mayor? The ED talked about the top down and the bottom up. I think it's important that we need to understand the importance of the rule of law. Because there are things that can be debatable, but there are things that must be upheld in order for us to have a viable urbanization process. I won't go into details. I hope they can elaborate more on that. But I just feel that we should try our best not to get ourselves into a populistic process. Because when you are in a position of authority, you should be able to guide your people wisely with a scientific and objective analysis and bring on the private sector to invest where they should and also to invest in the public good and not just let things go away. Thank you.
Okay. Now I feel it. So you have 9 questions, more or less. And we'll start by the question directed to a given panelist. We have the gender question to the three of you. They say right to property, right to land. How do you manage to get women, including in customary laws, access to land, access to property? Madam Mayor.
Well, for Liberia, I'll speak from the point of view of Liberia. When you look at Liberia, Liberia is the first country in Africa to have a democratically elected female president, our own Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. We in Liberia have no discrimination where women own property and whether they can own it or not own it. If you have the funds or your family dies, someone in the family, most of the time the land is evenly divided between daughters and sons. And I see Ellen shaking her head. We all have experienced it. If you're in my age group, you've had to deal with that in the last 10, 20 years. Where parents leave property, you and your brothers have to decide who will get it. We don't have discrimination in Liberia in land ownership. It is evenly divided. If you can buy it, whether you're a woman or a man, it's yours for the taking.
Is it the same in Kenya? Go ahead.
In Kenya, it's very different. In fact, it's a subject that's debated and talked about so much because you'll find some of my friends will say, no, Ivy, you are supposed to get married and get into your husband's family and not have access to my parents' land. It's still very much there. And what I think should be done is women like us who are empowered or who know better, we need to advocate for the right of women because I believe I have the right to my father's land just like my brother does. So it's something that we need to really advocate
on.
Do you
have it now?
Sorry?
Do you have it in your custom now? The right to inherit from your father?
In my custom it is that my brothers are the ones who are supposed to inherit the land.
Okay. Yes. So you, but how are we going to advocate then?
Oh, we have many discussions. Oh, even in already, like I've told you, it's something that we discuss a lot. And what I'm glad that she brought it up because now it's something that I'm going to do a bit more specified that as women we have that right. So it's our duty.
So Sheila.
I think the battle is at two fronts. There are certain countries, including in India, where women have a right to property, but the familial patriarchal culture makes women abdicate that right and hand it over to the guys, to the men and to their brothers. So that's one thing. So there is a social movement that needs to get women to feel comfortable in demanding their rights and getting it. The second thing is that when you come to our movement as slum dwellers, a very important part of our work is to build the capacity of women to articulate these positions in their environment and to get their families to agree. Because we know, all of us know, that laws alone do not produce action on the ground, that you need social mores and traditions to change to do that. And I think 3 generations of women have to work on this. Grannies, mummies, and daughters.
Very good. Very good. Now, Madam Mayor, you say you are working with slum dwellers, and a question was raised. Are they not illegal? Are they legal? Are you comforting the illegality by working with them?
Many of the land that we have slum dwellers living on in Liberia today is government-owned. We have them living in the swamp. Someone spoke about the environment. It's a problem in Liberia today. We have them living on the beaches. They just take, beaches are government owned in Liberia. They don't belong to people. Most of the land on the beaches are for the government. So they put settlements. The largest slum in Liberia today is on land that you and I would consider prime property in the developing world. A slum would never be there. But here they are in Monrovia. West Point is occupying the largest piece of real estate that is illegally owned. To get them off that, it would take the strong will of the national government and the local government working in partnership to make sure we either upgrade it or we give them alternative land to be able to build on. The problem with that is The problem with that is many of them look at Monrovia as being an urban setting where they have jobs, opportunity, and if you want to take them outside of Monrovia, I'm speaking from Monrovia's point of view, they will not want to move outside of Monrovia unless you create an environment where they will have jobs, they will have medical attention, they will have schools, they will have all the social benefits that Monrovia provide them with. So you have a problem. We do have the problem. Illegal land is not owned by private citizens. Very little of that is happening. But the majority of the slum dwellers live on government-owned land. And it will take national will, not just the mayor or the city or anyone, to get them to be able to either agree for you to go in there and do a holistic upgrading or relocate them by them freely agreeing to move on their own, not forcing them off the land.
Thank you. We had two question links. The first one, and let's say the fifth one, saying, are you not too classical by this north-south thing? Is it worth trying trilateral, multilateral, and so on? And how can you be innovative enough to get out of this north-south and be more integrative? I will ask first UN Habitat on this one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't think that the urbanization is going to happen or not to happen in relation to cooperation or external aid. I think that urbanization, it's, as I said, a collective and a political issue. And if there's no a clarity on the existing society, there's no cooperation that will address any problem. Even if the Chinese put some motorways here and there, that doesn't guarantee that the urbanization is going to go well. In fact, I am very skeptic about urbanization that is led by infrastructures. As our colleague of the European Union has said, this kind of sectorial intervention with a little bit of money here and there that in one place puts 20 kilometers of motorway, in another place it puts a hospital, in another place it puts a little bit of housing, and in another place it puts a little bit of these rapid bus systems. This usually, as is not integrated, is not integrated in a common urban vision, not just doesn't help much the city, sometimes even makes the solutions more complex. And I think that this is not the proper way to address the urban issue. The proper way to address the urban issue is the design of the legal framework, and this is the first and most important aspect of urbanization, a clear definition of the legal network of urban legislation, because at the end, every city is an act of law, and as the DED has said, it's ruled by the law, and it cannot be done in another manner. You need some rules and regulations. And the problem is that usually there are too many rules and regulations, copied from the West, too complex, and in most of the cases, not implemented. And this is the worst of the situations, because in not implementing a rules and regulation, the current authority loses its authority, because nobody follows the authority. The second aspect is the physical and the urban design, which is absent also. In that sense, for example, at least 50% of the land of a city should be public land. I am referring unbuilt land for roads and open spaces. And in Africa, we are doing satellite photographies of many cities, and the percentage of land which is used for common services is about 10%. That it means that, in general, in Africa, you have a deficit of 40% of public land in most of the cities. And this is a huge challenge, because nobody knows how to run a city with only 10% of the land being used as a common good. And the third aspect is the financial design. You need a financial design of the city. You don't need a financial design of the Hambi, but you need a financial design of the city, okay? Because you have expenditures. And then if you have expenditures, you need to have income. And even if you want to get money from somebody, you need to demonstrate that you are able to collect yourself some money. Okay? Because nobody is going to lend you money for free. Then the legal design, the physical design, the urban planning, and the financial design are the three legs, the three pillars of urbanization. And if that is not there, what is going to happen is that you will have spontaneous urbanization. And spontaneous urbanization is something that has happened in human history during many centuries in every part of the world. Slum dwellers, they have been in Brussels for many years. And slum dwellers, they were in London in the time of Dickens, and a lot of literature was created around these facts. Then what is needed is a political will to transform the city. And once you have a political will, there are the tools to do so. But no thing can substitute the political will.
Okay. Thank you very much. We've got a question that is very, one that I want really to address. There are others, unfortunately, maybe will not have time to address them. But one that says, you say that there is a this problem of financing cities. And what is the problem of this financing cities? Do you have any, what are the risks and how to mitigate them? And I'll give the floor to AFD and EC. What are the risks exactly?
Merci. La réponse à cette question.
Thank you. This question about the risks, starting from what Mr. Klaus just said, he mentioned leadership, vision, infrastructure, civil services, the ability to collect taxes. All these things are prerequisite. Once you have all that in place, and when you do have leadership, changes can happen. And I'm going to mention an example outside Africa, Medellin in Latin America. you had vision, long-term public policy, the financial funding infrastructures were there, actors that committed and were involved, and the change is major. Development banks donors, if they don't take risk, what are they for? We must take risk where commercial banks want to act. DACA was a case. The risk is part of what we do. You can have risks because of weaknesses in public policies and levying taxes that is a system with shortcomings. But you analyze all this in an objective manner, and our role is to take risks. Not enough institutions that are ready to do so. When you talk about investing, many people are offering consultancy services, people who are ready to fund infrastructures, even without a vision. Institutions, some institutions are ready to commit in funding, but not enough when you talk about long-term programming for cities. This is what I meant when I took the floor earlier on. There's another question that was not asked. Is ODD-11 an objective per se? Is DG-11? We have a specific objective for cities, and this is a very positive point.
Yes. What question? We have two questions here. It's on the financing the cities and that on north, south, all of those. This north, south, is it worth it to present to still be that classical? This is what.
So.
Briefly.
Very briefly. Shall I breathe? So I think that. Development assistance has been coming into countries and into cities, sometimes doing good, sometimes doing harm. And a lot of it is to do with the extent of dialogue, consensus building, and decision making that's being done. And maybe the Chinese are the most recent ones, but I think we can show many, many decades of interventions that may not necessarily be the priorities of localities. So the question goes back to saying, can we create equality and consensus between those who have to offer possibilities and those who need them? The second very important thing, which is, I think, critical in these discussions, is for people to understand what is needed. And the reality is that this urban transition is still going on. The rule of law that Aisa was talking about is presently extremely exclusive. It pushes. It's like the question we asked her. If they are illegal, how can you talk to them? The fact is that 60 to 80% of cities are illegal. So there are lots of changes that have to happen, and a lot of risks today of making investments lie in all these muddy waters. So I think an important situation is to change that, and that responsibilities as much of the citizens and their representatives, both local and national, and those who want to help them. I don't think there's an easy solution to this. You have to work hard.
Okay. Let me tell you that I'm struck by the fact that we didn't answer directly the question. Dr. Close said cities are there to stay, be it China, Turkey, Europe, US, to fund them in Africa. It doesn't matter. What matters, and I quote you, Dr. Close, is to have the three pillars right: the legal framework, the urban design and the financial design. But anybody can come if you have this right. And then you also said that this legal framework should start by knowing who does what in the city. And I'm short in this advocating of the subsidiarity principle. Solve the problem at the closest level to the people where it is efficiently addressed. But it doesn't say that you avoid the other levels of governance, but you encourage a collaborative way. Then you responded also to another question on the risk and said, this question is on our arm as cities because we need to have a leadership which is clear, we need to have a vision of where we are going, and we need to have a public policy that is stable so that people know how to play in the playground you are setting. This is what you said. But what we didn't know exactly, there is a question that is not clearly addressed here, is this issue of energy. We didn't address that, but we leave it because we don't have time to do that. The question of smart cities, I want that you talk on this one because it is in the air everywhere. Smart cities are going to solve everything. What do you think, Dr. Close?
Yeah. I am in favor of the smart city as everybody, because nobody is going to defend the stupid city. Then all this kind of trademarks or good phrases are as good as they are able to transmit a message. You associated the message to the smart city of, I quote you, technology. I wouldn't say that the smart city is the technological city. I would say that the smart city is the one that is able to address the three pillars of urbanization in a good manner. The legislation, urban planning, and financial design. This is a smart city. And if you have this smart city, probably it would be an excellent market for telecommunications, high tech, and all that. But let's put the things where they need to be. And usually the horse is in front of the chariot, not the other way around. And if we don't have a clear urban strategy, that is not going to be solved by technology. If you have a city that is unsafe because there's no national safety policy or because there's no social redistribution of wealth, don't expect to have a good city through technology. Then technology at every moment, it's an instrument for the society, and that it's for good or for bad, it's going to use for good or for bad, depending of the intentions that's behind it. Let me say a little bit about energy, because energy is extremely important in urbanization, because once we move people to the cities from rural areas, the consumption of energy multiplies by a factor of 10, tenfold. Whenever, every time that somebody moves to the city, the energy consumption multiplies by 10. Then energy is fundamental. And I think that the poor part of the world has a right to use energy, because energy is a common good. Then climate change is not about telling the people not use energy. The developing world, we don't have the right to tell that to the developing world. The issue of climate change is that the current use of energy generates a lot of greenhouse gases that are polluting the ecosystem. And then we need to change that. Okay? We need to change what it's a problem from the ecosystem. But from the use of energy, I am in favor that the poor of the world, they can multiply their energy consumption. Here, the real question, is that why are not we able now to agree on a carbon-free energy generation in the world, planet Earth? And this is not something that is decided by the mayors, by the way. I am coming back to one of the questions that you introduced half an hour before. The number of people who take the decision of what is the which form the energy is generated, it's a very small bunch of people. And I think that if you think yourself 5 minutes, you can identify most of them. Mm-hmm. Then, don't pass the responsibility of climate change to the mayors again. Mm-hmm. The mayors are not the ones who have generated the greenhouse emissions. And the mayors, by the way, they are always ready to help to diminish the emissions. But the ones who have decided which kind of energy we use are not the mayors. Then in Paris, what we are hoping for, it's an agreement of the ones who emit greenhouses, generate the emissions of greenhouses, gases, to change the system of producing energy. And on top of that, we know that there are alternative technologies. Then don't mix the thing, because one of the problems of today, and with a lot of, I would say, a lot of communication, sometimes too much communication, is that you can begin to pass the responsibilities to others. No. Climate change, it has a very limited and a very clear responsibility actors. And those are the ones who need to agree on changing the matrix of emission of greenhouse gases. And we hope that they will do in Paris 21. Huh?
Thank you so much, Dr. Claus, for these clarifications. And, normally, I was supposed to table again this question to the audience, but I don't think it is worth it because you choose very clearly that what is needed is to get the institutional and the framework right. That's clear. But we have two questions to you on this session before I give the final word to the youth and the EC, our host. It's the evaluation of this session. We didn't have the machine, the technologies that could have facilitated this, but how many of you find this was excellent, satisfactory, moderate, below expectation, unsatisfactory? How many of you find that we met what you expected? Excellent. Who's find it excellent? Satisfactory. Okay, the majority find it satisfactory and excellent. Who find it very boring? No one. Thank you for me. Number two, what do you take with you? And this is the question I will ask also my panelists. What do you take with you out of this? Is it meeting your interest? Who find that it meeting his interest excellently? Who? Oh, nobody. Okay. Four, five. Satisfactory. Okay, so it's fine. I don't continue. Or very bad. Nobody. So we are Oh, there is one who find it very bad. You have to explain why. No, okay. I want a maximum 2 sentences of takeaways from our youth and our host, your youth. What do you take from here?
This has been a very interesting discussion, and I personally have learned a lot. And like she mentioned, there's a difference between like our discussions and our implementation, who does what. So for me, I am keen on how this is going to be implemented, especially in African cities over the next few years, to ensure that we have the framework that is needed to ensure that cities are places where people can actually find the opportunities that they look for. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So what is going to change thanks to this session at the EU?
Let me say that I will be a little bit longer than 30 seconds. I want to say that what I came out from this session is, first of all, we should stop thinking or looking at urbanization as a big problem, but we should rather look at the challenges and opportunities that it brings to us. Second, we have to scale up efforts, both at the, beneficiary countries level, national administration, local administration, and at the level of international agencies and donors, to scale up in order to work more on urban development. I buy the idea of the three pillars, policy framework or legal framework, as you want to call it, urban design and financial design. This is, for me, is really the master. This comes before building infrastructure. Also, it came out that infrastructure is very expensive, and we need there to mobilize resource, not only from the usual suspect, but also for a private sector. So there we need to cover the risks of investing in infrastructure. And the last that he came out, I think, is this relation between bottom-up or top-down. We have to be very balanced in this. We need both approaches, and especially we need to understand the role of everybody, including the role of the leaders. This is what I got from this session.
Excellent, excellent. I think, yes, they deserve it. They deserve it. Now it's time to close this session. And I was impressed by the quality of this panel. Very educative. And I hope that these words that we just heard are commitments to go and help the institution to evolve. And the wisdom coming from the youth, saying care of the implementation, care of who is doing what, but be mindful that cities are here to stay, and find a way to have cities a better place to live in. Thank you so much.